Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda, Sri Advaita Gadadhar Sivasati Gaur Bhaktivinoda, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So we would humbly request the devotees who are sitting near the altar not to put their back directly to the deities. So if you can sit on a slight angle, so your back is going to face the Lord. Okay. So this is slide number one, just to again to give you a little introduction for those of you who are not here. So this seminar is about reading and studying Prabhupada's books. And last night we covered the preliminaries. And a recap would be that as time goes on, there are four elements: the instructions, the content, the issue, and the application. Content, actually it's instructions, issues, content, and Prabhupada's intention that he gave for giving that instruction. And we see, as time goes on, the different generations of Srila Prabhupada's disciples, first generation are Prabhupada's direct disciples, second generation are you, those who are disciples of Prabhupada's disciples, and then you will also, again, become the spiritual masters and have disciples. So four generations, and as time goes on, each of those elements, the instructions, the issues, the content, and eventually the intention behind the instructions, gradually starts to fade one by one. And the instructions remain, but the issues, the content, and the concept that was given by Prabhupada to solve the issues in that context becomes lost by time. So we talked about that and how to study Srila Prabhupada's books. We offered prayers to the Srimad Bhagavatam. I think many of you have a copy of the prayers.
Right?
Yeah, more for those who don't have copies. These are beautiful prayers recited by one of the greatest of all proponents of Srimad Bhagavatam Sanatana Goswami, his prayers and glorification to the Bhagavatam. And it's highly recommended that we recite these prayers before reading or approaching the Bhagavatam. So I know many of you are here for the first time, so it's hard for me to recap the whole seminar that we did yesterday, because we spent 2 hours discussing these points. It is quite detailed, so for you who missed the first half, try to get the recordings, or what you could do is maybe we can send you somewhat of a synopsis or a summary of what was done on your email. So we have to jump to slide number 35, because tonight is the last slide where we're going to present this. So slide 35, go to slide 34, I think it is. Okay. So, one of the things is personal application. What does this have to do with you? To apply the Krishna conscious theology with reference to your external practices and internal development, so as to develop appropriate Vaishnava qualities and behavior. So, learning the philosophy and then practicing it according to these two principles: how you perform your devotional service and how it develops your relationship with Krishna. As your heart becomes purified, your awareness and your absorption, and of course your attraction to Krishna increases more and more. What does this have to do with you? So any comment on that? You have to think about this. What does this have to do with you? Yeah. Okay. Any comments? So what are some of the appropriate qualities and behavior of a Vaishnava that helps to develop the philosophical principles in both external development and internal development and external practice? Humility, right. We mentioned humility. Without humility, nothing becomes absorbed. The false ego is like a block. So when one practices humility, they are like a sponge. A sponge absorbs. And sometimes absorbs both the messages and understands the nature of the practice. And what is the quality and what is the behavior? What is the ideal Vaishnava behavior? What would you say in one word a Vaishnava is ideal in behavior, if you had to sum it up in maybe a few words? Perfect gentleman. Prabhupada's statement, perfect lady, perfect gentleman. And what does that mean in practice?
Compassion.
I'm looking for one word.
Compassion.
Yeah. How does he relate, how does she relate to everyone? That's the word. Gives respects to everyone. Acknowledges everyone's existence and gives respects to that person who is the soul seated within the body. To respect everyone, the perfect gentleman, the perfect lady. So these are the behaviors and the qualities of one who is practicing. And what about internal development? How does internal development progress? How do we develop internally?
That we follow the principles and to read and that we hear about that we apply.
How to apply what we hear? Yeah, that's true. Internal development is absorption in whatever you're doing. Whether you're in kirtan, whether you're doing your seva, or whatever you're doing, if you're practicing externally properly, for example, if you're chanting the holy names, but you're not chanting with attention, internal development doesn't happen. But if you're chanting with attention and absorption, then your internal development is moving. So absorption according to the principle of proper practice. Okay, that's just an example. Okay, move on to the next slide. Okay, here we go, our friend on the bottom. So someone want to read that?
Simply quoting verses like a parrot will not be very much beneficial. One must apply jhana, vijhana, salita. We must know the vijhana, how practically. That is taught by the Goswamis.
So we have a parrot and we have Prabhupada. So a parrot can memorize verses, I remember I was in one city and there was a nice parrot and they taught him to chant and he would go, Hare Krishna, Ram, Ram, Ram. Clear. Better than most Vaishnavas. Really clear, nice to hear. But if you ask them, you know, what are you doing? Quack, quack. He doesn't know what he's doing. He doesn't know the meaning behind what he's doing. So we can expect that from a parrot. So simply to learn verses is nice, but Prabhupada says one must apply knowledge, realization, and practice. So that's applying the knowledge in practice brings about vijnana. Vijnana means realized knowledge. If you know something theoretically, you really don't know it well. But if you know something by intuitive knowledge or realization, then you know that object, whatever it is. If you heard pizza tastes good, but you haven't tried it, so you can tell everyone pizza tastes good, you won't have much potency because they'll ask you, well, you know, what's it like? I never tried it, but I just heard. You have to actually take the object and experience it. And that means, you see, spiritual knowledge is applicable and realizable. So when we apply it, we realize it. Just like we were having kirtan. So one of the elements of kirtan is enthusiasm. The more enthusiastic you are for kirtan, the more the holy name reveals itself through the kirtan. So if we do something enthusiastic as opposed to doing something mechanical, it's a completely different experience. Completely different. So, okay, there are persons who know many verses. And just like there was one time one devotee, he knew the whole Bhagavad Gita by heart. And he was a new boy. And of course he impressed the other devotees. So they thought, let's bring him to Prabhupada. So they brought him to Prabhupada, and he's standing there, and this other devotee says, Srila Prabhupada, this devotee knows the entire Bhagavad Gita in my heart. Prabhupada went, looked at the devotee was talking, didn't even look at the other person, and said, is there any service he can do? Is there any service he can do? So what he was saying, he wasn't so much impressed by the person's learning. But if he serves, then that will actually be the development of his knowledge. He wasn't doing any service. He was just simply memorizing verses. So through the application of the knowledge, the realization comes. And then when you speak, then it has potency. Otherwise, it's just words. So then there's one verse. Who knows this verse from the Bhagavad Gita that Mr. Parrot is giving us? Let's see, I'm going to test your Shastric referential knowledge. Who knows what verse this is? It's one of the most rhyming verses in the entire verse. But samsi jarnani yataya vidhaya anyani ki granati maropahadi tata sarirani vidhaya jarnani anani anyani samyani avarvarani dehi. Beautiful verse. Which verse? Who knows? Come on. Where's all the Panditjis?
You are asking number.
Yeah. Oh. Don't look at your phone to find out the number.
Like who body knows? Exchanges the dresses, we are changing.
Huh?
Like the bodies changes the dresses.
Okay, what verse is it?
2 sentences.
Huh?
215.
215 is exactly wrong.
Close.
Yes, Janatan. Janaki Ram. 222. Second chapter, 22nd verse. So, it's nice to know the reference. Okay. Just testing your Shastra knowledge. Okay. Jai Jai Radha Shyam Sundar, Radha Shyam Sundar, Jai Jai Radha Shyam Sundar, Radha Shyam Sundar, Shyam Nandi Pandana He. Preaching application. Okay, now we're getting into preaching. So here's Srila Prabhupada, when one priest and some other dignitaries and important people. And here's Prabhupada in Hippie Hill. This is Hippie Hill in San Francisco, 1967. To enhance your desire and ability to preach effectively. Okay, so you see there's two different types of settings. So Prabhupada is preaching according to time, place, and circumstance. Okay, someone ought to read.
I wish to encourage all my disciples to very carefully learn this philosophy of Krishna consciousness, because there are so many preachers who will be required to bring this message to all corners of the earth.
Do we need more preachers? Okay, we're going to have the sign up preacher club tonight. Who wants to sign up to become a preacher? Don't rush. Just stand in line. Yeah. Okay, we got one volunteer. Anyone else? Okay. Those who are not preaching, who wants to sign up? The benefit is you go back to Godhead. That's the only benefit. So preaching simply means to somehow or other change the heart or bring the heart closer of a living entity towards Krishna. Preaching doesn't mean you have to study books and become very deeply versed in philosophical knowledge. That is one form of preaching. Here Prabhupada is referring to that kind of preacher. We need people who can speak messages. So what is the qualification for preaching?
Realization.
Not necessarily. Realization gives potency to your preaching. But before you get realization, you might
teaching with example. Teaching with example.
Being an example in your own practice, that's an example. But there's
following the example.
You may not preach also. But what is it about
preaching? Compassion, realization.
That's okay.
Now,
let's talk about what you have to do to preach. What do you have to do? You have to repeat. She got it. Just repeat what you heard. That's all. You hear something, repeat it. And as you keep repeating it, it will become more and more understandable. And like that. And then you develop realization. But even without realization, you can repeat.
Question.
Yes.
Okay, you said now that to be able to preach, we should repeat Srila Prabhupada's words, what he said. But sometimes when we listen to a preacher,
who is just repeating, it's maybe not touching the heart, because it's different. Prabhupada had all the realization, and when he was saying it, it was
powerful.
Yes, powerful. Of course, I'm not saying that we should invent our own philosophy or something like that, but should a preacher consider that he preaches at least up to some level what he realized? Because otherwise, that preaching is just dry or even not attractive. I'm just asking.
That's true, or it could be pretense.
Yes.
But the point is that even if you're not preaching and you want somewhere to start, what do you do? Just repeat. So repeat those things. And Lord Chaitanya gave the directions to the Korma Brahman, and he said, anyone you meet, tell them about Krishna. Anyone you meet, teach them to chant Hare Krishna. Now that's easy. Now anyone can do that, right? You meet a person, you start becoming friends, you talk. Here's a nice mantra. Or here's some prasadam. Or this book is deep in philosophical knowledge about God. So there's different ways. But Prabhupada's making a particular point. We need more preachers, especially today. The preachers in our movement who make preaching their service are overwhelmed. There's 1,000 places to go. So many people want people to come. The world is more receptive to spiritual knowledge now than it's been in a long time. So we need preachers. If one can accept this little bit of difficulty, that means one has to think of the welfare of others. But the thing is, when you preach, you learn. We spoke about that the other day. As you repeat something, you also develop the knowledge of that subject matter. So we also benefit individually. So what Prabhupada is saying here is that our movement is a preaching movement. It's not a cup of tea movement where we just flip some chapatis, watch some videos, feel good about ourselves, pat each other on the back and say, Hare Krishna, see you next Sunday. That's not our movement. Our movement means to go out and make people Krishna conscious. So today we had the Harinam. That Harinam is very powerful. Very powerful. That's one of the more direct forms of preaching. Because just simply by bringing the holy name into the atmosphere, it purifies the atmosphere. The atmosphere is overloaded with sinful activities. We're bringing Krishna's name into that atmosphere. That atmosphere is changing simply by the power of the devotees chanting and dancing. And others, they don't even understand. I remember I was watching a video of the devotees were chanting in Denver, Colorado. It was on New Year's Eve. And Denver is a cold place. It gets super cold in the wintertime. And so the partiers celebrating New Year's Eve were out on the streets doing their thing. And the devotees came. And so you can see the kirtan is going on, and people from the outside are jumping into the kirtan. They're dancing. They're a little maybe intoxicated. And they're having a good time. So this was all being recorded. At the same time, there was voice recording that was going on. So you could hear it. One friend said to his other friend, what are they saying? And the other one said, I don't know, but it's really nice. He couldn't figure it out. He couldn't even hear it. Maybe for him it was hard to decipher the names. But it was so full of spiritual energy, they were uplifted. And that's the power of congregational chanting, that devotees can uplift any environment, even for people thinking, oh, I don't know what I'm doing, but I sure like it. So that's the power of bringing the holy name into society, bringing the books into society. Prabhupada said, book distribution will remain the number one form of preaching in our movement. There's no more direct way to bring Krishna consciousness than distributing books. But we also have seminars, we have lectures, we have study groups, we have different outreach programs. These are all a part of the preaching program. So we should all be thinking, either let me start something or let me join something and become an element of preaching for others. A devotee will never really be happy if they only think about their own spiritual life. You'll do that in the beginning as you practice in the early, but as you start making advancements, you find that you want to, you need to relate to others by giving them the same message. Something that makes you happy, just like if there's something that makes you happy, and you're really happy about that, what is the feeling you get from that? What do you want to do?
Share.
You want to share it. When you see someone else feeling the same happiness or something similar, you become even happier. So sharing something that is wonderful makes you more happier and of course benefits that other person. So that's preaching, is to share this message of Krishna consciousness with others. Okay, so here we go. Another reader? Don't be shy.
That you should memorize the words of my books and then speak them in your own words. Do not adulterate or change anything. Then you will be the perfect preacher.
So memorize, and then what we say, present it according to your own realization. What might that? And it's like if you memorize a verse, just like that verse your parent memorized, said, so you take the same words and you just repeat it in your own words, which says that as a person puts on new garments, discarding the old and useless one, similarly the soul puts on new bodies, discarding the old and useless ones. So then you can change that around, is that from life to life, we change our bodies, like from day to day, we change our clothes. Same thing. Although you didn't say the exact words, you had the exact same meaning. So you can take the words and make it simplified for people to understand. But Prabhupada said, don't adulterate. In other words, don't add anything to make it, try to make it better. Just try to present it accordingly. So we're talking about preaching now. Okay, next.
Theological application. To help create nine Vaishnava theologians who are expert in assisting the society through application of Shastic knowledge to a wide range of personal, social, moral, topical, and theological issues.
Okay, so to create learned Vaishnavas who are expert in assisting the society through application of Shastrics. So Prabhupada say, study the books. And then present the topics, social, moral, topical, theological, philosophical, leelas, different topics that will be, you know, presented through your own studies like that. Okay, this is quite self-explanatory.
The Bhagavad Gita is spoken by the Lord so that human society can be perfectly organized from all angles of vision, politically, socially, economically, philosophically, and religiously. The many fundamental of human society can be reformed by the Krishna consciousness movement.
See, maybe we don't completely accept that, but although we are a spiritual movement, it has a very sound social, economic, political, and religious philosophical basis. In practice and in theory, both. Mm-hmm. What's our economical philosophy?
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's for bringing in money. Yeah. Well, what's the best way we can organize an economical society? Varnashram. Varna and ashram. That's economical and it's social. Politically, what is our political philosophy?
Monarchy.
Yeah.
Those
leads
should be
Rajarishis. Monarchy. He hit it. Monarchy. We're a monarchical society, basically. That we teach that the ideal political society is monarchy. People don't like monarchy because there's no good monarchs. But that's the highest and most developed society, is to have an enlightened leader. A person who is enlightened in political management and at the same time directed by Shastric evidence or Shastric knowledge. Yeah. Monarchy, yeah. So Prabhupada talks about that, Rajarshis, right? Socially, Ashram Dharma, economically, live simply, philosophically, that's obvious, and religiously, we follow the four regulative principles. That's the religious aspect. Everything's there in Krishna consciousness. You don't have to go outside. And Prabhupada wanted us to take his books and teachings and formulate these different aspects within the society. Because devotees, we've seen that, devotees feel spiritually enlightened, but they see it's not really practical, our how to live. We're not living, what we say, according to what would be the philosophical teachings. So we still need to work on what we call the social, economical, and political aspects of our society, which is Varnashram Dharma, and establishing proper management with that. So we're still, that's a work in progress, to use a cliche. Okay, but the Bhagavad Gita, it's all there in the Bhagavad Gita. Okay. Oops. Next one. Who are those personalities?
Krishna
Balaram. From you. Where are they from?
Alachu?
You're probably right. I don't know. Yeah, because it was Lakshmi Moni he put it together. Yes, she would be from Alachu. Yeah. It's Alachu, yeah. Okay. Faith and conviction. To build and maintain your faith and conviction in
process of Krishna consciousness,
and
Shastra, and its foundation in your
life. Two things, in the process, and in building the foundation of your life based around Shastra. Any comments on this? This is quite direct. Anybody have any doubts in the process? Does the process work?
Yes. But we have doubts, otherwise we would be already...
Now the question is, do you have doubts in the process, or do you have doubts in yourself, that is the ability to practice the process? Do you have doubts in the leadership that's giving the process? Where is your doubt?
It's everywhere.
And what does Krishna say in the Bhagavad Gita? He says, for the doubting soul, there's never happiness in this world or in the next. So he says, doubts are like demons. And there's one demon called Madhusudana. And Krishna killed that demon of doubt with the weapon of transcendental knowledge. So building your faith and conviction, both of these comes by transcendental, But your faith becomes strong in association with people who are fixed in that process. There's where your faith develops. The thing is, if you think, I can't do it, then you're saying that Krishna can't do it. You can't do it, it's true, but if you depend on Krishna and the mercy of Krishna coming through the process, then you become empowered to do it. A devotee always thinks, I can't do anything, but if I pray to the Lord, I pray to my spiritual master, I beg for mercy, then whatever I need will be available. This is our success. And to get that, we need to have association. If we don't take regular association from devotees, we will develop, and when we say, our faith will be very, what we say, malleable. In other words, it can change at any point due to a circumstance. But Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, one who has firm faith, even in the most dangerous situation, they're not moved, even if it's life-threatening. I was talking to one devotee today. I'm going to mention her name, or his name. And the devotee was telling me they had an unfortunate circumstance. But due to understanding that this unfortunate circumstance was given to them for a reason, they see that in the future this unfortunate circumstance will become beneficial. That's faith. That is faith. Something unfortunate, obviously from all points of view, it doesn't look good. But the devotee knows, Krishna does two things. He wants something to happen, or he allows something to happen. When he allows something to happen, and you accept it, then there's some message in there. That in the future, something else will come to bring me closer to Krishna, to purify me from some anartha like that. Yes?
Regarding all that you were saying, I'm just thinking that it also requires a very large amounts of sincerity from our side. You know, because we see, okay, sometimes we want to be this and that, but actually we should allow Krishna to work through us, you know, so we can change and accept all that you were saying. Because I can hardly imagine that from a point when you have no faith at all, and then you start with Adam Shraddha, and then immediately you end up, I don't know, with complete faith. Obviously it's a process, as Prabhupada
right,
said.
Right.
And then in that process we should allow Krishna actually to do things in
Yeah. You have to, see what, okay. What's my next step? How to develop more faith, how to develop more, what we say, knowledge.
Because sometimes it's not happening as we were thinking it will happen. You know, we get problems, we get tested, we get challenged.
We only get tested. Some tests are just mild little tests in order to give you a little bit of realization of what you need to do, and others are pretty severe to help you just take full shelter of the Lord. Or to purify you from some attachment. If you want to go to college and you want to get a PhD, you can't say, well, I don't want to go through the test, I just give me a PhD, I'll come to the classes, don't give me the test. I'll attend all the classes, but I don't want any tests. Teacher says, I think you're in the wrong school. No, testing brings out your good qualities. Testing forces you to go deeper into your own practice. Testing means more dependence on Krishna. All right, I mean, we're all going to get tested. The time of death will come. And when you realize there's only one way to go and your body's finished and you're ready to die, will you consider that a test? I would. These smaller tests are helping us to prepare for that test. Because that test is the ultimate. That's the Maha exam. And then if you pass the other tests, then that will be easy to pass too. But if you haven't passed the other test, it's going to be very difficult to understand why Krishna is doing what he's doing to you. And why, you know. Yes.
Is there any difference between Krishna allows and Krishna wants for us?
Yeah. He allows and he wants. He wants, that's his will. There's a verse in the 13th chapter. He says he's the overseer and permitter. So one of the qualities of the super soul is he allows things to happen just to see how you accept it. Or sometimes he just doesn't interfere with your desires. And therefore, because you act in a certain way, he allows you to get that reaction. Just to show you that this is not where it's at. Or to give you some benefits sometimes. Sometimes a devotee will gain a lot of money, and then because of that, their devotional service will go down. So Krishna may allow that just to teach the devotee that attachment you have to wealth is actually taking away from you. But that's rare. That's rare. That's using a pretty extreme example. The best example is that on a day-to-day basis, if we act outside of Krishna consciousness, Krishna allows certain reactions to happen to us just to teach us. They're not full, they're partial reactions, just as a message. You have a, yes, you're next, but after Radha Vinod.
I've heard from a devotee that mostly when some devotee leaves Krishna consciousness, it's because of having doubts in the process.
Having doubts?
Doubts in the process. That's why I was just wondering what kind of mistake can we make which loses, which leads to losing faith.
Not necessarily. What happens is when you lose your taste for chanting, for associating, then you're in a very precarious situation. So you can do one of two things. The right thing is to pray and stay fixed in Krishna consciousness despite no taste, knowing that if you continue to taste will return. And the other thing is what happens is devotees go looking for taste through something material to fulfill that void. Because the nature of the soul is happiness, and so we're always looking for some type of pleasure. So when we miss it on the spiritual level, because of whatever reason, we may also look for it in the wrong area. And then that takes us farther away from Krishna. So what you do when that taste is gone is that you just have to somehow or other have that faith to stay fixed in the process and knowing it will return. What causes taste to go? Sometimes it's say offenses. If we can continue to commit offenses, not correcting it, after some time the taste will go.
And this is also the case when sometimes I see that devotees are getting hurt from other devotees, and that's why they just stay far.
Well, it's stay far away from the devotees who are hurting you, but stay in association of other devotees. It's not that you give up all association. That's practical. Maybe you cannot associate with certain devotees, but others you should find an association with. And if you're married, every woman should also have friends and every husband, every wife should have friends outside, every husband should have friends outside. That will keep their relationship strong. So we need association. We're social beings. We're by nature social. Right? So, therefore, we don't want to lose association, but we may have to choose that association that is inspiring, beneficial, and not taking us down. That we can do. Rupa Goswami mentions that. He said one should associate with like-minded devotees. So people who have similar natures attract each other. Similar natures, similar likings. If you like the same thing, you also associate with that person. Well, you avoid that other association. And that's a practical thing. But we shouldn't leave Krishna consciousness because of something that's gone wrong with a certain individual or a certain situation. One of my godbrothers, very senior, he was very senior for many years in the beginning, but then he got burnt by leaders. Certain leaders hurt him pretty bad. And of course, he gradually started to move away. And it affected his Krishna consciousness. After some time, he had a whole change. He came back, and in coming back, he understood in a reflective way why these things happened to him and what caused them to happen. He started to analyze, and then he was able to forgive those people who apparently hurt him. And he writes about that. Now he's fixed in Krishna consciousness, he travels around the world preaching. He's not a sannyasi. He's a grihastha with family. So, yeah. Yes, question in the back there.
You said that Krishna is trying to make us in different situations to take shelter of his lotus feet and to guide us in some way. So how do we know that this is happening? Is it happening all the time? Either we are not devotees or yes, we are devotees, or it's more happening when we
If you want to be a devotee, Krishna is always trying to help you. If you want to somehow mix your devotion with material sense gratification, you may get a little bit of both, but you won't get Krishna. You'll get a little bit of opportunities for service. Hopefully Krishna is encouraging you to give up that other activity and bringing you closer. The more sincere you are, the more you'll find that Krishna is working with you at every moment. He's working with everyone every moment, but some people don't want to work with Krishna. So they say, leave me alone, Krishna. Don't give me, you know, just come back when things are nice. But we want to go back to Godhead. Going back to Godhead means perfection. That means the end of all miseries and the attainment of ultimate happiness and ultimate knowledge. That's our nature. So we can enjoy the process of Krishna consciousness, but in that process of enjoyment, chanting is nice, visiting holy places is very nice, associating with devotees is very wonderful, taking prasadam is nice, kirtans is nice. But you're going to find in every one of them there's an element of purification that comes along with that nicety. And then you have to see and accept it. Like that. Okay, so we'll move on. Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Ready? Who's greater? One of the men?
Faith is the complete condition that simply by serving the Supreme Lord, Sri Krishna, one can achieve all perfection. After reading Bhagavad Gita, one should give up all other engagements and adopt the service of the Supreme Lord, Krishna. If one is convinced of this philosophy of life, this is faith. That is faith.
Yeah. Simply by serving the Supreme Lord, one can achieve all perfection. And this is the statement of Bhagavad Gita. Krishna says, you surrender to me, everything is taken care of. I take charge over this one. Faith. The Christians have a nice thing about faith. It's really nice, if I can remember right. Faith is the proof of something yet to come, and the evidence of something unseen. Faith is the proof of something yet to come, and the evidence of something unseen.
Can you please explain a little bit?
If you have faith, that's proof that something will come. Something wonderful will come. And that faith is the evidence of something that is not seen, but you know it's available. It'll come in the course of time. The evidence of something unseen. Faith is evidence. Nice. That's pretty good, eh? Here we go. Pramurti?
How is faith created by association with devotees? Faith.
Okay. Here's Queen Kunti's prayer.
I wish that all those calamities would happen again and again, so that we could see you again and again. Your singing means that we will no longer see repeated birds and bats.
Would you say she has faith?
Absolutely.
What kind of faith does she have?
Complete
faith. What is she asking for?
Calamities.
Has anybody asked for calamities? Nobody wants calamities, but she wants calamities. Why? Because that helps her to see Krishna more and more. Her position is interesting. She's Krishna's aunt. She's respected. She's from a royal family. She's wealthy. She's, in all sense of the word, she has all good qualities. But she's afraid that because of all these good qualities, I'll forget you. So give me some difficulties, and that way I can remember you. So that's real faith. Okay, any comments on that? You don't have to pray for calamities. They'll come anyway. But when they come, take shelter. What is that verse? Govinda Nandanan, your favorite verse? Yeah. Sing it. Translation? Who wants to give the translation? My dear Lord, you have given me this suffering. And actually, I want to thank you very much. Actually, the suffering you have given me is only a small token of actually what I really deserve. Because you're so kind, you have minimized what I'm supposed to get. Therefore, I take shelter of you in devotional service. That's that verse. Paraphrased. So in other words, the Lord puts his devotee in a difficult situation, the devotee thanks the Lord and becomes more dedicated to the service of the Lord. In Mukti Padesha Dayabhak is the last line which says, my dear Lord, which the Lord is actually saying, if you pray like this, then you're guaranteed to go back to Godhead. He says, the kingdom of God becomes your rightful inheritance. One who accepts difficulties has the mercy of the Lord and thanks the Lord. Mm-hmm. You sure you're in the right movement? Okay. We want all flowers and roses. They're coming. They'll come. But it's a process. Yes. 10th canto, chapter 14, verse number 8, spoken by Lord Brahma. After Brahma foiled Krishna, after Krishna foiled Brahma, when Brahma tried to steal the calves and cows, cavern boys, Brahma was defeated by Krishna and then spoke this verse. Krishna made him look like a fowl. Okay, here's more on faith.
Whatever the case, we must have faith in the work of Krishna. When we purchase a ticket of Pan America or Air India, we have faith that the company will take us to our destination. Faith is created because the company is authorized. Our faith should not be blind. Therefore, we should accept that which is recognized.
So, when we get onto the airplane, we don't even know the name of the pilot. We don't know if he's blind or not. So, maybe he had an argument with his wife, and she just broke up with him. And he's in a distressful condition, now he has to fly his plane. So, we don't really know, but we have faith that, okay, the airline says he's okay, he can fly. He's authorized to take you. So we have faith that it will happen. We're actually putting our life in the hands of that pilot, right? It's like that when you think about it. So in the same way, knowing that Krishna always acts for the welfare of his devotee, devotees can have faith. Therefore, not being blind, as Prabhupada said, means we should understand that faith through knowledge, through scripture, through association. And then a faith will become strong. Therefore, what do you do to increase your faith? What can we do right now to increase our faith, right this moment?
Discuss,
or ask questions. If you have any doubts, or if you have moved to something there, present the question. If you have no questions, there's two reasons why you have no questions. One, you know everything. And two, you can't think of anything to ask. But somewhere in between, there's questions. So, are we fixed in our Krishna consciousness? Do we have any doubts in the process? We have doubts in ourselves, we have doubts in Krishna, we have doubts in the Guru, we have doubts in whatever. Or, we're okay and we're just going along. Okay? So, questions. Okay, who's that? From where? Vrindavan Dham, Sri Sri Krishna, Gaurdithai. Okay. Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Okay.
Evaluation. help you to develop analytical, interpretive, and evaluative skills, particularly in respect to practical application of Shastric knowledge.
Does some of you find difficulty in the English as opposed to, if this was in Croatian, it'd be easier to think, right? Do you find that the English is a block in understanding?
No.
No? Everyone is okay with English?
Yes.
It's a little challenge, right? In Hungary, they don't speak much English. Anyway, evaluation. To help you develop both analytical, interpretive, evaluative skills, particularly with respect to the practical application of Shastra. How to apply the knowledge in practice. Any comments on that? Any examples of that?
Yeah, I wanted to ask you, Maharaj, is evaluative skills. I mean, I understand the term, but how can we actually do evaluation of something that we should put our faith into, you know, it's supposed to...
Take it apart. What is it meaning? What is it saying? First, take it apart and piece by piece, and then try to evaluate it. For example, well, a particular verse, we did that exercise yesterday with that verse. So, in understanding it, analyzing it, evaluating it, we came up with more and more points. And each verse is like that. You take a verse, and then you see what's being said, and you see how it applies to you. If you have any personal experience with this philosophy in your day-to-day life, so this is all evaluative. How does it benefit you, or is it too far removed from you to have any immediate benefit? So you look at things from a philosophical point of view, evaluating. So this particular, you know, seminar is helping you to think deeper. I'm not just giving you terminologies so you can absorb. Now this is about thinking. We're asking everyone to think, to really think. In terms of your own practice, in terms of the philosophy, yes.
Maharaj, is also evaluation meant like when we are reflecting the day, how the things were happening and how we noticed the arrangements by Krishna and how can we grow from that also?
Yeah. Why is Krishna doing this? Why I planned it this way, it came out this way. So what's the message? Yes.
Before we went to this slide, you said that we should ask questions if we have doubts. Well, in my experience, it is always very nice and acceptable in the association of the devotees when we have favorable experiences and we try to encourage each other. But when it comes to doubts, sometimes people are even, some, I'm not saying all, are even afraid
to express the doubt.
That both the speaker who has a doubt, but also if the surrounding community is not very favorable, you know, to your doubts, because they may have the same doubt, but they never want to place it out, you know, and then you're bringing out disturbance. So I don't know. It was to my personal experience. I'm not.
And you just need to look for a different arena to bring that out.
No, yeah, I just wanted to say that it's maybe more personal, you know, when you have a group of more intimate friends, then these things may be come out easier, you know, and then you discuss it more freely.
That's true.
Otherwise, you know, because if you are in an open space and then you place out on the doubts, someone gets angry with you for saying something like that.
Basically, you're saying the problem is there, but there's no solution because of the fact that the community is not closely knit. They're not really working together as a community, they're not helping each other. If they were, then doubts would be an opportunity to serve that devotee. When someone has a problem and they come to you, here's a chance for you to do some service for that devotee. And that's what we want, opportunities for service. Opportunity to help someone. And in the secular field, people look for chances to do something for someone because they find some satisfaction in helping others. So we should be also like that. And not like, oh, it's only the preachers who do the help and everybody else has the problems. Now each community should develop that mood where they can, at least with a few devotees, where you can open your heart, you can express your feelings, you can get your doubts heard and at the same time not be judged.
Yes. Because I also noticed with some devotees that if these doubts keep piling, then from some, and eventually at one point, then
you
start leaving. Yeah, you go away. Because you cannot address it, you're either very close, you're shy or whatever, or you get smashed by asking something, so what is this, how you can even doubt that, or, you know, and then you think, okay, I will just, you know, do my own program, whatever.
It used to be like that in the past. Now it's getting where devotees are starting to mature in such a way that there's always a system where you can go to someone and get some answers and without being judged, without being criticized. It should be like that. Sadhu Sangha, association with devotees. We're not a bunch of individuals who come together as a group. We're actually a society that wants to develop relationship with Krishna, at the same time, relationships with each other. You can't have a relationship with Krishna if you don't have a relationship with devotees. It's just not possible. Because Krishna puts more emphasis on your relationship with others than he does with you. If you want to have a relationship with him, then you don't really want to deal with others. You're pretty much saying to him that, you know, everybody else is useless except you. Or I can't relate to anybody else. So. Sadhu Sangha, Sadhu Sangha. This is important. As this is, okay, so how closely knit we are as a group, as things go on normally, it kind of like varies. But say there's a crisis. Say somebody attacks the temple with guns and starts shooting. How much the devotees all of a sudden come together as a group to resist that and start to care about each other on a personal level? So whenever there's a crisis, it brings about unity. So don't let Krishna force a crisis on us to bring a unity. He'll do that sometimes, to help bring unity. Just do it naturally. It's important. We need each other. That's the fact. We need each other. There's nobody who doesn't need the association and the friendship of other devotees, no money. Okay, so, I don't know. Hope I'm not taking too much time here. Okay. And develop the ability to make appropriate choices in your life, so you may go different ways. The ability to give advice and counsel that is actually relevant and practically useful in society. So these are just some points. So from reading, studying, evaluating, practicing, we develop the ability to do, to advise and counsel others. This is interesting. Arjuna kind of disobeyed Krishna, or he hesitated, and Prabhupada glorifies him. So read, this is really powerful.
Although Krishna advised Arjuna to kill, Arjuna did not take it. This is consciousness. Even though there is duty, we have to see what would be the effect of that duty. Nothing should be done blindly. This is the nature of duty.
And that gave Krishna a chance to explain the philosophy of Bhagavad Gita. His doubts became the opportunity for spreading knowledge all over the world. So he hesitated. It's not, he didn't lose his faith in Krishna. He lost his faith in the instruction. And he needed clarification. But therefore Krishna took enough time and thoroughly answered his questions until his doubts were completely eradicated. So Prabhupada said nothing should be done blindly.
Maharaj also with Ashwatthama. Was this also with Ashwatthama? He was in the.
I'm sorry, I can't hear
you. Was this also in the Lila with Ashwatthama when he was. He catch him and he needed to kill him and then he was giving instructions to kill him and not to kill him?
Ashwatthama? This was Ashwatthama. And then there was a big discussion, because this is from the 7th chapter of Bhagavad Gita. Ashwatthama had committed a heinous crime by killing the five sleeping sons of Draupadi. Draupadi didn't take any offense personally, but Krishna, Bhima, and Arjuna did. Krishna said to kill him, Arjuna didn't take it right away. And then there's a big discussion based on this. And basically, the solution was gotten after a long discussion. Draupadi didn't want to have him killed because she said, I am a mother and I have lost my children, and therefore, if he gets killed, how would his mother feel? She was thinking of the welfare of Ashwatthama's mother, who would also feel unhappy because of her son being killed, although she just lost five sons. She didn't want to have that same bad feeling happen to someone else. But Bhima said, kill him immediately. Billy Bhima was so strong. Arjuna was kind of like in the middle. Krishna agreed with Bhima and said, kill him also. But Arjuna hesitated, and then based on that, a solution was given, and he was ridiculed and ostracized. He wasn't killed personally, which was good as killing him, because he lost all his honor and prestige and association. He got a punishment that was equal to death.
How can we make a difference between doing something blindly and having faith? What is the difference between these two?
Well, when you act in knowledge, that's not doing something blindly means you're not acting in knowledge. Here's where we get a little bit intricate. Prabhupada said, blind faith in the right thing is also good. But then before you can understand to have that faith, you have to also develop some knowledge based on your experience with that person or that process. So by practicing Krishna consciousness and developing some knowledge, the faith develops, and as you experience that faith in practice, it becomes stronger and stronger. And then something may be even more challenging, where something is asked of you and you don't have that faith to do it. And then you might say, oh, okay, well, now what do I do? And you act on faith and not simply on blind, you act out of blind faith and not simply on realized faith. So it's tricky, it's really tricky. It depends on your level of practice and on your faith in the process. How knowledge and faith correspond to each other and evolve to higher and higher practices. In the Bible, Job, the devil said to Job, the devil said to God, oh, Job is such a nice devotee of yours, but if you start taking everything away from him, just see what kind of devotee is it. God said, all right, you can test him, but don't kill him. And so his house burned down, he lost all his crops, his family went away, they all died. Everything was taken away from Job. Job never lost his faith. And then the last one was, God said to Job, kill your son. Job had that faith, and he was about to kill his son, and then the Lord stopped him. Just to show the devil, who was challenging the faith of Job, to God, that he has great faith. So, yeah. Now, that's an extreme example. But what is Prabhupada telling us? Jai Hare Krishna. Can we do that? Do we have faith that the Holy Name will purify us and take us to, you know, higher consciousness? Do we have faith that by associating the world with devotees, we can find happiness and satisfaction in that association? And inspiration in our devotional practice. So these are small tests of faith. What kind of faith are we getting? Yes. Tita.
We may disagree even with our guru. Or GBC that presents us in our attention. So how to deal with that?
Question.
Yeah.
Question the point of disagreement and question it.
Because I have experience, if you question, then there still can be some disturbance.
It depends how you question. If you challenge, if you question in a challenging mood, then you're pretty much saying, I'm right and you're wrong. But questioning in a submissive mood means, I don't agree, but I want to learn to help you understand. So it's the mood you challenge and you question. And that's acceptable. Arjuna questioned Krishna. But he didn't doubt his faith in Krishna. If we lost our faith in our spiritual master, that's the only thing. But we may lose faith in the instructions he gives. So therefore questions are acceptable. And sometimes we question for clarification. So that's okay. Is it okay?
Is that enough? Maharaj, I would like to make a comment or a question the same and regarding the faith. What I saw in practice when I was dealing with people, I saw that people with weak faith, usually people who remain in their comfort zone. When people go out from their comfort zone through preaching, through like having opportunity to surrender to Krishna, faith immediately comes through realizations.
Yeah, if you get out of your comfort zone and you take a chance and you do something that you know is right but you don't know what the results are going to be, then it increases your faith. as long as it's in the line of Krishna's instructions. If it's outside of Krishna's instructions, or the spiritual master's instructions, which you should get, then you're putting yourself in a situation where something may go wrong, and at the same time, will cause your faith to become less. So before you do something, get advice. That's get advice, get direction. That's the part of sarasanga also. You see, the thing is, the mind doesn't want, the mind says, hey man, I can figure it out. I don't need anybody to tell me. I don't got it yet, but I will get it. It's the nature of the mind to dictate to you that, you know, you don't need anybody to tell you. You can figure it out. And then after a while, you realize the mind is tricking you. When you have a question, ask it. And that's humility too.
Also a little comment to that. Usually we, if we don't want to ask questions, it's because we stick to our own idea and actually we don't want to hear the answer.
Yeah, but if you have a problem, you want to get it over.
I know, but it's like, you know, what, as soon as you place yourself in a position that you are asking questions in this humble way, attitude, you are actually given an opportunity to change something within. Right. And, but then we are mostly attached to how it is now, and then we just want to...
Well, we're attached to the idea that it may cost me some sense gratification. I want to solve the problem, but I want to still hang on to sense gratification at the same time. It's like sometimes the devotees say, you know, the same thing keeps happening to me over and over again. Yeah, because you keep doing the same thing. If you do the same thing over and over, you're going to get the same results. When you change, you get a different result. Yes.
Sometimes I saw that some devotees have a personal problem and ask many, many devotees about it. And they get many, many opinions, and they just
that's
become
not
confused.
Good.
So
that's not good.
Just go to us.
Better to find someone who you can have faith and trust in, and then quit and focus on that. Because if you get a lot of opinions, you may pick and choose which one you like.
That's why.
And that may not be good. I get it all the time. Like people come to me with problems and I ask them, who else did you talk to first? Well, and that's okay. But then I say, well, what did he say? Or what did she say? And then, based on what that other person says, then I'll speak. But not until I hear what they heard before. It's not that I say, okay, you have to go away because you heard. No. Okay. But what is that? What advice have you received in the past? And from there we can work. We want to be honest. I'm trying to become Krishna conscious. Okay. There you go. There's Srila Prabhupada dancing and ecstasy. Anybody know where that place that is? I think that's Berry Place in London. The old days, back in 1968, 69. No, later than that, 1970. Understanding and appreciating Guru Vishnu Srila Prabhupada, perpetuating that understanding within the ISKCON Sahaja and its members. We're all little fans now. Understanding of Srila Prabhupada's Guru Vishnu gives you a clear sense of identity and purpose within his society and a balanced sense of one's place within ISKCON's overall mission. And that's a pretty powerful statement. Understanding his mood and the mission that comes The mission of the Buddha comes when it gives you a clear sense of identity and purpose within the society, and a balanced sense of one's place within them. So you see there's various ways you can serve. You can serve as a deity worship, you can serve the cows, you can do harinam. Everyone fits in somewhere. Where do you fit in? Find your place somewhere. Cooking, worshiping, chanting, caring for cows, preaching, so many things. What is Prabhupada's mood and mission? His mood is giving, and his mission is giving Krishna. His mood is to give, and the mission is to give Krishna. Okay.
In conclusion, if a disciple is very serious to execute the mission of a spiritual master, he immediately associates with the Supreme Personality of Godhead by body or bhava. This is the only secret of success in seeing the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Instead of being eager to see the Lord in Sambhusha or Vrindavan, but at the same time engaging in sense gratification, if one instead sticks to the principle of following the words of the spiritual master, he will see the Supreme Lord without it.
So here's the key. Firm faith in the words of the spiritual master. Prabhupada said, my spiritual master is wrong, but he's right. Yasya devi parabhaktir, tata devi tata patasyaita kartita yata pakisanaka mahapranaha. One who has implicit faith in both God and Guru, all the imports of all Vedic knowledge are automatically revealed within the heart of a devotee. That faith. We have to develop that faith more. Okay, let's see where are we. It's getting a little late. Should we stop now? There's a few more slides and we'll be over. Studying and preaching the scriptures is necessary that we have a moral and academic integrity to the interpretation by an application of the Shastra word. So that goes with integrity, doing what is right even when it's difficult. This is a very important part. Something I like may not be right, but something that is difficult, although it's right, builds character. People who sacrifice what is right for what is easy never really find happiness in life. They're always adjusting to find what fits them. So something may be difficult, but if it's right, that's integrity, moral, academic integrity, even when it's difficult. Okay. I'm going to leave it up to you now to ask the questions. Examples of poor or dishonest use of scripture. Read.
The tendency to quote only half of the sloka when the second half modifies or qualifies the first. The personality of Godhead replied, the renunciation of work and work in devotion above good proliferation. But of the two, work in devotional service is better than renunciation of work. Choosing the quoting only verses evidence that support our own opinion and neglecting others. Citing context relevant materials as absolute truth or quoting out of context. Arguing or debating largely or only on the basis of emotional appeal. Quoting a verse that doesn't actually explain
that which we are discussing, although on whose meaning is unclear or ambiguous.
Examples of poor or dishonest usage, Shastra. So we can also do that too. Any questions about those? I'm not going to get into each one of them because it's kind of late, but if you have a question on that, so you might see. That's why if you read the Shastras and you hear lectures, you can start to see how that is being presented in relationship to the actual information. Like Prabhupada said, you know, married life, if you have a good wife, it's like the boat that carries you across the ocean of material existence. So having a good wife is a secure way to cross the ocean of material existence. And then Prabhupada said, sex, licit or illicit, is both illicit. So which one do you want? Now there seems to be two contrary quotes. Each one are true in relationship to time, place, circumstance. That's why you can read Shastra your whole life and become totally confused. Unless you have a guru to help you understand how this knowledge applies according to time, place, and circumstance. Prabhupada contradicted himself so many times, but he never contradicted himself once. He said things that were opposite, and at the same time, they're all complementary according to time, place, and circumstance. So that's why this is, you know, the Shastras are very difficult to understand. The truth is hidden in the hearts of the self-realized soul. So only through guru can we understand Shastra. And then Prabhupada made the Shastras, in his presentation of the Shastra, he explained it so thoroughly that it's pretty much clear. But then again, you see that there are apparently contradictions, or what we say, different angles of vision on the same thing that's being said. So therefore, yeah, we need to study, and we need to ask questions, and we need to practice according to, you know, our level of realization. Very complicated philosophy. Now, if you really want to get down to the essence, chant Hare Krishna and be happy. Bas. That's what you have to do. And if you can do that, perfection. But if you can't do that, start reading.
To help us do that.
Yeah, to help you do that, exactly. So this is interesting because even within the Shastras we can get people can come out. I mean, I was listening to Bhanuswami, he's a genius on Shastras. He was saying there's so many verses in the Srimad Bhagavatam that you can interpret in a personal, impersonal way. You can interpret it that way. But you know, the Gita has been interpreted in 100 different ways. The Prabhupada said, what was Krishna's intention when he spoke these words? That's only known by the pure devotee. But was that many devotees previously to come in Krishna consciousness, they read many versions of the Gita, but never really became a devotee. And then when they read Bhagavad Gita as it is, everything became clear. Same words. So we need guru and shastra. Guru teaches on the basis of Shastra. And Shastras understand through the process of spirit Guru. But simply by reading, you will get something. But then again, if you don't get any questions, then you're either not reading properly, or at the same time, you have realized everything and you're beyond all questions. Yes.
Since Srila Prabhupada also commented on the Shastra, do we need to learn Guru or not?
He commented on the Shastras, but we, as Prabhupada said, you can also comment on my comments. In other words, to bring out deeper and more relevant meanings according to time, place, and circumstances. Prabhupada says certain things that weren't clear or that apply to a certain situation, but he didn't qualify that. I can think of a few things. And certain statements that Prabhupada made, and even now the TBC can't figure out. So, what is he actually saying? Is it that famous one? You know the one I'm talking about, right? The fourth canto? The name of that one? That about rape. A woman enjoys a man who is expert at rape. That's the statement. Now, what woman enjoys getting raped? Nobody. In fact, it causes, you know, psychological damage to a lady who undergoes such catastrophes. But Prabhupada writes that. So what is he saying? Does anybody want to comment? No. Because even now, there's some, what did Prabhupada mean by that statement? And there is an answer to it. I have it on my computer. I have to read the answer. I'm not going to say what I think it is. But Prabhupada used certain terminologies that have, that are certain, what we say, may have many meanings. And for one culture or for one mindset, it means one thing, and for one other culture and mindset, it means something different. So therefore, yeah. Asking questions for clarification helps to bring, you know, proper understanding. I was talking to Malati about it, and she said, you know, we should have asked Prabhupada when he was here. Now that he's gone, we can't get the complete understanding. But I found a statement that was gleaned out of a discussion by senior devotee, which I think is the actual answer to that. It's on my computer, and I won't try to remember it unless I can actually say it according to the words, because it'll get misunderstood if I don't say it exactly right. But even what I say, according to what I found, and I'm convinced it's right, is not accepted by others. And Prabhupada says certain things. But he made certain clarifications. There is certain things that were very clear. Chant Hare Krishna. That is the essence of our spiritual practice. That he wasn't ambiguous about. Or, you know, he was emphasizing. Everything will come to the holy name. That he emphasized. So this little list shows how the knowledge can be misunderstood or understood in a different way that seems to be the right way. And these are just some nice things, okay? Somebody is misusing the word soham, aham brahmasmi, and therefore I am the supreme, but that is not the Vedic word. But soham does not mean I am God. Soham means I am also the same quality. So there's an example. The word soham means I am him, or I am the... But Prabhupada says, no, according to Shastras, it means I'm the same quality. Just like Prabhupada would use the word nirguna. And the Mayavadis interpret, guna means qualities and nir means without. So the Mayavadis interpret it, the absolute truth is without qualities. But Prabhupada said, no, it means the absolute truth is without material qualities. So therefore, it is with the guru who has realized it, gives the correct understanding. Same with this soham. Who knows where that is from? Shisivara Gokulananda. Okay. We must take, somebody want to read that? I don't know, my voice is going.
We must take responsibility for our learning and develop healthy study habits. Developing a taste and appreciation for the study of Srila Prabhupada's books and understanding the relevance of Shastra within one's life can inspire us to study and study well. Understanding how we learn and what we must do to facilitate our learning will assist us in developing the study skills necessary to learn.
So taking responsibility of learning by developing a taste and appreciation and the understanding the relevance will help us to become inspired to study deeper and develop the skills necessary. Okay. This is that verse that we started off with.
All the devotees connected with this Krishna consciousness movement must read all the books that have been translated, Chaitanya Charitamrita, Krishna Bhagavatam, Bhagavad Gita, and others. Otherwise, after some time, they will simply eat, sleep, and fall down to their position. Thus, they will lose the opportunity to attain an eternal, blissful life of transcendental
pleasure. Bhajan Lila 25:270. Prabhupada makes the point. If you don't develop a shastric acumen, after some time, you will go back to the bodily conception of mind. The shastras are a direction, they're also a taste, and they're a weapon against keeping Maya away. And they also bring us closer to Krishna through hearing about his pastimes. Where is that? Vrindavan Sri Sri Krishna Maharaj Ki Jai.
One should develop the ability to see through the eyes of Shastra with a Krishna conscious worldview. The ultimate goal is to realize Krishna's presence everywhere and to seek his hand in everything.
That picture is that the sadhu is seeing the Krishna in the heart of the different types of living entities, the elephant, the Brahmin, the cow, the dog, and the low-class person. Seeing through knowledge, seeing with the eye of knowledge, Shastra Shakshis. Oops. Okay, what happened? Where did we go? Okay. Okay, next one. And what is this one? It's too hard to read. Can you read that?
Personal realization does not mean that one should, out of vanity, attempt to show one's own learning by trying to surpass the previous acharya. He must have full confidence in the previous acharya, and at the same time he must realize the subject matter so nicely that he can present the matter for the particular circumstances in a suitable manner. The original purpose of the text must be maintained. No obscure meaning should be
screwed
out of it. Yet it should be presented in an interesting manner for the understanding of the audience. This is called realization.
Wow. That's the perfection of preaching. Confidence in the previous acharyas, learning, understanding the subject matter, presenting in a suitable manner, presenting in an interesting way according to the type of audience. Okay. That's it. Oops. I think that's the end. Okay, here's the last one. Knowledge and understanding.
Reaching application, faith in conviction, Prabhupada's modern mission, evaluation, academic and moral integrity, responsibility for learning, Shastra Chakshus.
So that's the topics we went through in this whole presentation. Okay, that's a summary. This is a PowerPoint summary. Yes.
Maharaj, by this quote that we should follow the teachings of past acharyas.
Thank you. Yes, go ahead.
Is it meant only with the acharya, official acharyas, like Srila Prabhupada, Bhaktivinoda Thakur, Bhaktisiddhanta, or is it also meant like a spiritual master that have shown by their example, who have really lived their life as it taught by Shastras? Like, who really showed that? Is it meant also through their teachings?
Well, we follow the Guru Parampara. What are the personalities you are referring to?
Like Bhakti Tirtha Maharaj showed really by all his life
people,
and dying.
People in our ISKCON movement who have been by Prabhupada's mood and mission and knowledge and practice it, have according to their own level of realization, have preached it and lived it accordingly. So we can be inspired by that. Why not? We're inspired by personal examples more than we are inspired by those examples that are somewhat distant from us, that are more philosophical. When we see in a living form that knowledge that we're reading about in our day-to-day life, how much an inspiration is that? That inspiration means I want to become like that, or I want to have developed those qualities. That's for sure. We inspire each other. That's why when you make an advancement, you're actually helping others simply by your presence and by your preaching. Okay, I know it's a little late. Sorry about that. But thank you very much. I hope this was somewhat beneficial. So my only last word is read the books. And as much as you can. And you'll find your whole perception of Krishna consciousness will grow in a very wonderful way. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Mother Lakshmi Moni, who developed this seminar, ki jai. And I have some prasadam.
Thank you.